Right. So, welcome everybody to this postgraduate teaching activity from the Apollo Hospital, Navi Mumbai, initiated by Dr. Siddharth Yadav and Dr. Agnivesh. Today's topic is probably the most important topic for postgraduates because almost 8 out of 10 or maybe, 80% of y'all will get a case of cheumatoid arthritis because it is the commonest pediatric orthopedic deformity which is kept as a case. Now, essentially, cheumatoid arthritis means that there is some sort of an angulation between the distal, the arm and the forearm. Essentially, the commonest cause of a cheumatoid arthritis is because of a distal humeral deformity. But sometimes, some deformities which involve intra-articular fractures around the elbow joint can also cause cheumatoid arthritis. Now you would say that we know all this and we've seen all this, but to understand really what cheumatoid arthritis is and why cheumatoid arthritis happens, you really need to go back and try and understand the supracondylar fracture, because cheumatoid arthritis in most instances, in most cases which are kept in the exam, and practically in orthopedic practice, is secondary to a malunited supracondylar fracture of the distal humerus in a child. As we know, there are three types of supracondylar fractures: the type 1, which is the undisplaced, the type 2, which is the angulated, and the type 3, which is the displaced fracture. The type 3 displaced fracture is further divided into severe unstable fractures, and these type 3 fractures with displacement, if not treated in time, if malreduced, unreduced, or if they present to you late, are the ones which will present with a cheumatoid arthritis deformity in most instances. So this is usually the culprit which leads to a malunion and eventually leading to cheumatoid arthritis. Now, the type 3 essentially is further divided into a low transverse, a lateral oblique, and a low sagittal, a high transverse, a medial oblique, and a high sagittal, right? Now, out of these, the low transverse, the lateral oblique, the high transverse, and the medial obliques are extremely unstable injuries. And many a times, despite trying to get a close reduction or even getting an open reduction, at times, you may not get an adequate reduction if they present to you within a specified period of time. If they do not present to you within a specified period of time and they malunite, most of these tend to go into a varus deformity. The reason for that is that usually there is a medial and a posterior displacement. Many a times, there may be a medial and an anterior displacement, what we call as the flexion type supracondylar. Very rarely in a supracondylar humeral fracture will you find a lateral kind of a displacement. And the reason for that is because your common flexor origin, which is attached to the medial epicondyle, tends to pull the distal fragment into varus and extension. At the same time, there is a displacement of the proximal fragment laterally, and this kind of a displacement leads to a block of the fracture, which prevents the fracture from reduction in the type 3 variety, and this leads to eventually a malunion if it is not treated. Now, this is a video which I'm going to play for about 10 minutes, and I just wanted to observe this. This is essentially the closed treatment of a supracondylar humerus fracture. This video is by James Beattie, and I would just want you to go through this because this is a beautiful video which depicts the closed reduction technique and pinning technique of supracondylar humerus fracture. So we shall see this technique and then go further. So he is telling you about how to first place the patient, where the C-arm should be, and how you should see under the C-arm. So this, so what was important there to understand is that you need to give traction, you need to adjust the varus and the valgus, and then you need to flex the distal fragment and eventually lock it. Now that was a type 2, so he did not have to, but in a type 3 fracture you need to pronate the forearm and hyperflex it so that your distal fragment becomes a part of the proximal fragment. This is for the extension type of supracondylar fractures. For the flexion type of supracondylar fractures, you need to reduce them in extension and then pin them. Now, if you look at the remodeling of a supracondylar fracture which has not been treated, most of them, when they are treated properly, will remodel. All of them, even if not treated, will remodel and the deformity will reduce. But the remodeling essentially takes place in the plane of the joint, which is the elbow joint, which takes place in the plane, which is the sagittal plane. In the coronal plane and the rotational plane, hardly any remodeling takes place. And that is why you find that many of the fractures which are united in varus are also united in some amount of internal rotation. So it is the rotation which is also important. The sagittal imbalance is also important, and the varus is also important. And when you examine a patient of supracondylar humerus fracture, you will have to see all these three, the sagittal deformity, the coronal plane deformity, as well as the rotational deformity. All these three deformities not only have to be seen, but also have to be quantified if you're going to treat a patient with a cubitus varus of the elbow. Now, as I have told you, most of these deformities are extra-articular. So what I mean by extra-articular is that these deformities do not involve the elbow joint. In short, what is happening is that the deformity is taking place at the site of the fracture, which is in the metaphysis of the distal humerus. The distal fragment is uniting in varus extension and internal rotation. Because of this, the deformity, though appears to be only in the coronal plane, there is also a sagittal and a rotational deformity. Okay, now this deformity is also called as gun stock deformity, and I have put it pictorially why it is called a gun stock. Because of the angle which is there between the gun stock and the barrel of the gun, it is called as a gun stock deformity. So there is a hyperextension in the sagittal plane, there is a gun stock deformity with cubitus varus, and there is an internal rotation in the transverse plane. All these three have to be quantified. Can you quantify them clinically? Yes. How can you quantify them clinically? By looking at the angle of varus and comparing it to the normal side, making a mid-arm line and a mid-forearm line, and connecting the two. The angle between these two is the angle of varus. Now, what about the angle of hyperextension or angle of extension, because which is there in the sagittal plane? That is, you can calculate by comparing the elbow extension on the normal side with the excessive degree of hyperextension on the affected side. The degree of hyperextension which is over and above that on the affected side as compared to the normal side is the amount of hyperextension deformity of the supracondylar fracture malunion. How do you calculate the rotational deformity? Now, this is something which is a little tricky to understand, but once you understand it, you will be able to quantify it. So what you do is there is something called as a Yamamoto test, wherein you ask the patient to extend and medially rotate the humerus, the shoulder at the level of the proximal humerus, and the amount of excessive internal rotation which is there in the affected limb as compared to that in the normal limb is the angle of excessive internal rotation malunion. Now, once you realize that this is not a single plane deformity, but a triplanar deformity, or what we call as a multiplanar deformity, you need to plan and correct most of these deformities. Now, the most difficult deformity out of them to correct is the rotational deformity. And many a times you just have to leave it there. The reason for that is that even if it unites in some amount of internal rotation, it really is never a problem because the shoulder can compensate. Also, correction of a remodeled internal rotation deformity is very, very difficult to get because your bone edges at the level of the osteotomy are quite thin, and to get a rotational correction with stability and fixing it is difficult. You can definitely take wedges, anterior based wedges to correct the extension deformity, and a lateral based wedge to correct the cubitus varus deformity. So you try and correct at least two out of these three deformities in most cases. Now, you, as I showed you, this is how you measure it. And once you measure it, then you know how much of deformity is there. That is the internal rotation test or the Yamamoto test. And that tells you what is the rotational deformity. Now, usually a cubitus varus will look like this. It is a malunited distal humerus fracture. And here, what is extremely important and which will come only with practice is to try and get the three bony points. Usually, the three bony points, that is the medial epicondyle, the lateral epicondyle, and the tip of the olecranon, they form a what you call as an equilateral triangle. And if there is any sort of a disturbance between the two, then that leads to a change of this triangle or the change in the bony point relationship as compared to the other side. Now, this is extremely important in the exam because what happens is many times the medial and the lateral pillars are thickened. And when the medial and the lateral pillars are thickened, it is very, very difficult to get the medial and the lateral epicondyle. The only way you can palpate the medial and the lateral epicondyle is when you start from the elbow joint, which is the soft tissue, and then you feel your first bony prominence is the epicondyles, or the epicondyles, which are easily palpable, right? And that will tell you the two points. The tip of the olecranon, it is not the olecranon process, but the tip of the olecranon is extremely important. Once you tell your examiner that the three-point bony relationship is maintained, this fracture is malunited in varus, extension, and internal rotation, it gives the examiner a complete idea that this is a malunited supracondylar fracture of the humerus. The examination has been correct and perfect, and that will solve 90% of your case. Remaining 10% is going to be how you're going to correct it. Now, what I have seen most people say in the exam or even say in the postgraduate clinics is that we will wait till the age of 18 years, till the remodeling happens. And once that happens and there is no growth remaining, we will correct this deformity. Now, please remember that this is an extra-articular non-progressive deformity. So even if you don't do anything to it, it is not going to worsen. It may get better with time, especially the sagittal plane deformity. The coronal plane deformity and the rotational deformity do not change. So please, whenever you get a malunited supracondylar fracture of the humerus causing cubitus varus, do not say that I will wait for skeletal maturity. It does not make sense. It is a cosmetic deformity right now. As a child, if you are to correct this deformity, you will get away with minimum amount of implant fixation. You will get away with a smaller wedge. You will get away with early healing. You will get away with a comparatively minor surgery as compared to doing it when the child is an adolescent or a young adult, where you would have to cut a lot of bone. You would have to fix it with plates in an adolescent or a young adult vis-a-vis wires in a small child. The amount of bone will be lesser removed if you compare, because the adult bone is a bigger bone. And as I said, this deformity does not remodel. So imagine removing a 30 degree wedge in an adult vis-a-vis removing a 30 degree wedge in a child. The amount of bone is definitely different. And again, doing it in the child, once it has healed well, the possibility of elbow stiffness is on the lesser side. Healing is faster and quicker. The periosteum is thicker. So all these things make cubitus varus surgery in the younger age group a big boon for us pediatric orthopedic surgeons. So please, whenever you get a case of cubitus varus, do not say that I will do it after skeletal maturity. If it is a cosmetic deformity, if it is going to affect his function in the near future or a distant future, then you need to correct the deformity when the deformity presents to you, which may be about anywhere between 6 months to 9 months. Why not earlier than that? Because if you do it earlier than that, many a times you can get heterotrophic ossification. So you need to go later than that. You need to do a preoperative planning clinically as well as an X-ray. So you basically, there are multiple lines which you can use to calculate the deformity, you can use the distal humeral diaphyseal line to the line which goes between the radius and the ulna, or you can use a line which goes from the distal humerus diaphysis to the ulna. Whatever it is, your deformity will approximately not change, maybe change by 2 or 3 degrees here and there. Now, what you have to remember is that you need to see the angle on the other side, the carrying angle on the opposite side. So you have to equalize the carrying angle on the opposite side. So the opposite side, if it is zero, the carrying angle, then this side has to be zero. If it is 10, then you have to make it 10. So you cannot kind of, you know, just do a deformity correction. Many a times you have to overcorrect so that the cosmesis is better and both the sides have an equal carrying angle, right? So your wedge will not be based upon getting it to zero, but sometimes even getting it to plus 10. This is minus 20, minus 25 varus to plus 10 degrees of valgus. So that is how you need to plan your surgery. The surgery is not a difficult one. You actually go through the lateral approach. You can easily expose the anterior and the posterior part of the distal humerus via the lateral approach. You can see the pillars. Once you do that, you put a small Homans retractor on both the sides. You know what wedge you have. You have done a preoperative planning. You can even take an intraoperative kind of a, you know, autoclaved, say a metallic kind of a wedge which you have cut out from some sort of a tin or some sort of an aluminium and place it on the bone, provided you have taken x-rays which are not magnified. Or you can even have a goniometer which is autoclaved, a metallic goniometer is available which is autoclaved. Or you can even do an eyeballing. Experienced pediatric orthopedic surgeons tend to do an eyeballing. What you need to be certain is that once you remove, before you remove the wedge, you need to keep a couple of wires into the proximal and the distal cortex, depending upon what sort of a fixation you want. If you want to put two wires across, then you can just keep wires in the distal fragment. If you want to do a sort of a screw and wiring sort of a construct, in that case, you need to kind of have proximal and distal fixations. Now, what sort of a wedge is good? Is it a lateral wedge which is good? Is it a part lateral, part open, part closed, which is good? Whether it is a dome, it is good. It all depends upon your experience and what is your level of comfort. You need to remember that when you remove a wedge of bone from the lateral side, and if you do not do a step cut osteotomy, step cut means leave a part of the medial part of the distal fragment, sorry, lateral part of the distal fragment, a small triangle there, so that the bulge which takes place because of the mismatch between the proximal and the distal fragment does not kind of lead to a cosmetic looking bump there. Because what happens is the moment you remove this particular wedge of bone and you close the wedge, what will happen is the medial, the proximal fragment, the lateral part, and the distal fragment, there will be some sort of a mismatch between the two, which will kind of lead to a not a very good cosmetic looking bump there. So there are various ways to circumvent this or to counter this. One is by making something called as a step cut osteotomy, wherein you kind of leave a lateral triangle there, or you can do a dome osteotomy and you can correct these deformities. So once you do that, this is how it is done. That is the surgical steps. You can correct these deformities. So many a times when you correct these deformities, you also need to remember that your wedge is not only lateral, but you have to also remove a kind of more posterior based wedge. And when you have a more posterior based wedge, you can correct not only the coronal plane deformity, but even the sagittal plane deformity. So if there is too much of flexion, too much of extension, then you can give flexion. If there is too much of flexion, then you can give extension. So for the extension types, you take an anterior based wedge. And for the flexion type, you take a posterior based wedge. right? So the wedge remains the same. Only thing is the base of the wedge, it is trapezoidal and it's not a triangular wedge. The other osteotomies which are mentioned are the step cut osteotomy, wherein you actually kind of remove a part of the a triangular part of bone and then try and wedge the distal fragment into the proximal fragment. This is not really recommended for supracondylar fractures. It is more for the lateral condylar fractures. Or the second method is basically a kind of a dome osteotomy, wherein you actually make a dome in the supracondylar region with the help of multiple drill holes, and then you correct the deformity by aligning the distal fragment to the proximal fragment. The biggest advantage of doing a dome osteotomy per se is that you do not remove any sort of a bone, but the dome osteotomy is a little technically more difficult and a little more demanding procedure, because you need to have a little bit of experience in trying to get the perfect dome, in rotating the perfect dome and getting the correct angular correction. Extremely important. One more thing which is very important is when you are creating a dome osteotomy, it is a very unstable kind of an osteotomy from the perspective that it goes back into varus. Not that it is unstable because you don't remove bone, but because it tends to go back into varus, and hence many of these have to be fixed with something which is more than K-wire. So a small kind of a mini plate may be required, which may have to go right from the distal metaphysis into the two pillars to fix this deformity. Once you do a dome osteotomy, this is extremely important for dome osteotomy. So basically the idea is that supracondylar fractures are the commonest cause of cubitus varus deformity. They are the commonest exam case to be kept. You should be very lucky if you get this case, because there are only two or three things which you need to know about this. One is that this is secondary to a malunited supracondylar humerus fracture. The reason for that is because the three-point bony relationship is maintained. That is one thing the examiner will expect. The second thing the examiner will expect from you is what is to quantify the deformity, which is how much degree of varus, which you will do by a goniometer comparing the right and the left side. What is the degree of hyperextension, which you will do by comparing the extension on the affected and the normal side. And what is the amount of rotation, which you will do by the Yamamoto test. The third thing is going to be, how are you going to treat this patient? Why are you going to treat this patient? Can you leave this patient alone? You can leave this patient alone, but his deformity will not correct. You need to correct it when it is cosmetically disfigured and deformed more than 10 to 15 degrees of varus, significant amount of hyperextension and internal rotation. So you need to correct these deformities, because these are cosmetic deformities. Do they cause functional problems? In most cases, they don't. But many a times, if these children are looking to become army recruits, want to do any heavy physical activity, want to get into contact sports, competitive sports, then they better have a straight elbow. Considering all these points, discussing it with the parents and with the child, you need to take a kind of a combined decision to correct this. That is going to be the next question. And the third question is going to be, what osteotomy are you going to do? So it is basically, don't name the osteotomy, because they will say, then what osteotomy, then what is the modified form of the osteotomy? So forget the name, don't mention, just say that I'm going to do whatever, a lateral closed wedge osteotomy, or a step cut osteotomy, or a dome osteotomy, right? Don't get into names, because it does not matter as long as you correct the deformity. Next question is going to be, how are you going to fix my osteotomy? I will fix it with K-wires. Next is going to be, what is your rehabilitation protocol? My rehabilitation protocol is going to be, I will take serial x-rays every 2 weeks and see how the fracture or the created fracture osteotomy is uniting. Once the osteotomy unites, I will remove the wires, and then I will start passive and active range of motion exercises over a period of time. I will tell the patient not to massage, and I will get a full range. So these are the questions which are common questions which are expected in the exam. Many a times they may ask you the various approaches to the distal humerus. So there is a posterior approach, there is an anterior lateral approach, there is an anterior medial approach, there is a medial approach, and there is a lateral approach. All these approaches will give you approach to the distal humerus. They are used for various reasons. The posterior approach is now used mainly in adults for an intra-articular distal humerus fracture, which requires an open reduction and internal fixation. If it is a supracondylar humerus fracture, which is irreducible on close reduction, then you can do either a medial or a lateral approach. You can, if at all there is a vascular injury or a neurovascular injury, then you do a medial approach. You see the vessel, you hand over the patient to the cardiac surgeon. Once you get a reduction and when you're sure that the vessel is not getting entrapped into the bone, you fix the bone. The cardiac surgeon either does an embolectomy or he repairs the vessels. The plastic surgeon does it. The nerve again will have to be repaired immediately, and the patient will have to be kept in a plaster slab till the time all this heals. In cubitus varus correction, there is not much of a problem as regards neurovascular issues, because usually you stay subperiosteal, so your anterior and posterior and medial structures not really come in the way if you go from the lateral side. So essentially, this is all you need to know about the cubitus varus deformity. This is all you will be asked about the cubitus varus deformity. There is nothing much more to understand in this. And I think my lecture has given a reasonable clarity to you when this comes to you as an exam case. Thank you.